I'm Richard Friend, and this is a special episode of Lost Laurel. In July 1982, I was only 9 years old, and the biggest story in town that year was the disappearance and murder of Stefanie Watson. The case went cold for 30 years, and in 2012, I wrote a piece marking the anniversary on my Lost Laurel blog. Somehow, that reignited the investigation, and an arrest was finally made. This is the unlikely story of how that all played out. I started Lost Laurel in 2011, collecting, documenting, and sharing little pieces of Laurel's retail history. It's usually lighthearted, virtual time travel through Laurel's pop culture. I try to stay away from things like crime, politics, and other heavy topics. But in 2012, I realized that it had been almost 30 years since the Stefanie Watson murder, which was such a vivid memory for me growing up. It really struck me that nothing had been written about it after all these years, especially considering the circumstances. Here's this beautiful young woman who disappears on what was supposed to be her last night in Laurel before leaving town. Her blood-stained car is found a few days later, and a month later, part of her skull is found. There are no suspects, no motives, and no arrests. Her body is never recovered, and the case goes cold. In fact, because there was no information to be found about it online, I had to eventually call the police to find out that the case was indeed still open. I wanted to write something about it in the context of Lost Laurel. Like the Kennedy assassination or the Challenger explosion, it was a chance to get people to remember and talk about where they were when this horrible thing occurred. But at the same time, I hope to finally learn who Stefanie Watson actually was. I've often said that this case reads like a New York Times bestseller, and the story of how this all came about isn't much different in that regard. Like a classic tragedy, it played out in three acts: Stefanie's disappearance, the grisly discovery of her car, and the discovery of her partial remains. And on this episode, I'll be relaying the story to you in three parts: the crime itself as it unfolded in 1982, the unlikely theory I found myself developing in my own research 30 years later, and the even more unlikely arrest that was finally made the following year. I'll also try to give you a sense of who Stefanie Watson really was, beyond just that photo on a missing persons flyer. Before we start, I want to say a few words about that flyer, which I learned was actually designed by Stefanie's co-workers at the Greater Laurel Beltsville Hospital. For most of us, sadly, it was the first we'd ever seen or heard of Stefanie Watson, and for the next 30 years, it seemed to be the only thing. At the start of my research, I couldn't find a single image of Stefanie, aside from the grainy 1982 coverage in the Laurel Leader, and even that was only available on microfilm. A big part of what motivated me to write about this case was the fact that virtually nothing had been written. There were no updates, no new leads, nothing. Our collective memory of Stefanie Watson was becoming as faded as this overly Xeroxed flyer. I wanted to at least try to bring her back into focus, back into Laurel's public consciousness 30 years later. This one's much clearer. This is one of the original flyers that's been in Stefanie's cold case file with the Prince George's County Police Department since 1982. This flyer is how most of Laurel was first introduced to Stefanie Watson 30 years ago. It, a lot of memories, and some important answers are finally starting to come into clear focus. Now, as we get into part one, I realize this is a rather dark subject, and this might be the only bit of comic relief you're going to get. This was me around 1982 at one of the playgrounds at Stewart Manor Apartments where I grew up. Like most kids in the early 1980s, I was a big comic book fan, and I was especially fascinated by those "earn prizes or cash" ads from the Olympic Sales Club that were always on the back covers. For some reason, this is what I had to have: a handheld computer racing game. But I will say this for it, though: to this day, it still works. In addition to selling door-to-door in every building at Stewart Manor, I set up shop in front of Zayre's, which was right across the street at Laurel Plaza. It's the current site of the Second Avenue thrift store today. Kind of strange seeing that parking lot filled again after years of being empty, but that's a good thing. In 1982, Zayre's was a well-trafficked, safe store. And for the most part, I felt completely safe standing outside the entrance and asking approaching customers if they'd be interested in buying something from my catalog. I was there during the summer mornings and early afternoons when it was still completely light out, but standing there alone could still be a bit scary for a kid. I remember it feeling extremely isolated at times, especially in the hours before that huge parking lot would fill up. It was here, in front of Zaire's, that I first saw the missing persons flyer about Stefanie Watson. Waiting for potential customers, I couldn't help staring at it. I'd read it again and again, trying to imagine what could have possibly happened to this pretty lady, and at the same time, trying not to imagine what might have happened. It was also a particularly scary time for kids in this country. Just 1 year earlier, in the summer of 1981, 6-year-old Adam Walsh was abducted and murdered in Florida. He'd been standing in front of a Sears store for only a few minutes when he disappeared. His severed head was found in a Vero Beach canal 2 weeks later. The rest of his body has never been found. The Adam Walsh case became global news. A movie was made, it prompted new legislation for child safety, and Adam's father, John Walsh, went on to become a well-known advocate for victims' rights and the host of America's Most Wanted. I'm not exaggerating when I say that I thought about Adam Walsh every time a stranger approached at Zaire's that summer. There were often long, lonely stretches of time those summer mornings in front of Zaire's when no customers would show. It seemed like it was just me and that flyer, just me and Stefanie Watson. Like most Laurel kids in 1982, I first heard about the details of the case in brief, sanitized tidbits from my parents and from overly exaggerated rumors spread by other kids. It was scary stuff, to be sure, even for adults. Rumors and speculation abounded in the days and weeks after she vanished on July 22, 1982. The general facts as I knew them at the time were stark and terribly grim. She had worked at the Greater Laurel Beltsville Hospital. Her car was found near Laurel Center Mall several days later, saturated with blood. And even more chilling, part of her skull was discovered over a month later in the woods at the dead end of Larchdale Road. I was too young to read this kind of stuff in the newspapers or listen to the news reports, but word spread fast throughout Laurel in the wake of Stefanie's disappearance. She'd gone missing on Thursday, July 22nd. Her car, a 1981 bronze Chevy Chevette, was found 4 days later on Monday, July 26th. This obviously isn't Stefanie's actual Chevette. Her tires were muddy, and clumps of weeds or brush were stuck in the driver's side door and grill, as if the car had been driven off-road. The interior was covered with blood. This photo is of Stefanie's car. This black and white photo actually ran in the Laurel Leader. The car had been found in the parking lot of the Middletown Apartments high-rise on 4th Street, just behind Laurel Center Mall, visible in this Leader photo of search crews canvassing the area near Laurel Lake. Mayor Michaels, a resident of the Middletown Apartments, first noticed the Chevette when she unwittingly parked her car next to it. Her daughter, Elaine, remarked how dirty it was. The police activity in the parking lot drew a great deal of attention, especially being right across the street from the busy Laurel Center Mall. Countless residents and curious onlookers got a view they immediately regretted when they peeked inside the car. As the Leader reported, "Bless her heart," said one woman when she saw the condition of the car and wondered about the missing Watson's fate. "It's too late for prayers now." Audrey Presley, the older sister of my two best friends, was there that day with their mom. They saw the car. She was the first to tell us younger kids about what they'd seen. I can't remember her exact words, but it was enough to convince us that Stefanie wasn't going to be found alive. I also learned that my uncle, Art Baxley, actually knew Stefanie casually. They both worked at the hospital. He was on the cleaning crew, and she worked as the night admissions clerk in the emergency room. Art was working that Thursday night when Stefanie failed to show up. It was supposed to be her last night at work, he said. She was moving to Texas the next week. "You know, I will take one more opportunity to lighten the mood here a bit. This is an earlier photo of Art and my dad on the left from 1978. If you'll notice, Art is wearing a t-shirt that literally says the word is. I remember this as a kid, Art and the is shirt. But if you look closer, you'll see that there used to be more letters, those felt ones that were ironed on, that spelled out Harrisburg, PA. That's 10 letters that had somehow worn off that shirt. And he still wore it. That takes skill. I have no idea where he got that shirt, and neither does he, having never ventured out of the DC area, probably a thrift store, but oddly enough, Stefanie Watson, whom he'd meet 4 years after this photo, was from Harrisburg, Pennsylvania. Newspaper coverage expanded from the Laurel Leader to the Washington Post throughout July and August, with periodical columns noting that the hunt for the missing woman was ongoing. More often than not, Stefanie's name was misspelled in the Post, adding insult to injury. When the leader reported the shocking news that her partial remains had been discovered on September 3rd, the headline proved that Laurel was on a first-name basis with this particular victim. With the news of a positive ID, an already dark cloud over Laurel took on an even more ominous hue. This was no longer a rescue mission for first responders. It was one of recovery. And worse, this was murder, one of, if not the most gruesome in this town's history. There were few clues, and when Stephanie's estranged husband, Wayne, was quickly and definitively ruled out as a suspect, there were no motives or suspects either. This fear was palpable for months, even as the case began to grow cold. The thought of someone loose out there capable of kidnapping and killing someone, and then leaving only a skull in the woods. It was a scary time. Police were able to roughly reconstruct Stephanie's final hours on Thursday, July 22nd, through interviews with co-workers and others who'd seen her, as well as family members who were expecting her that Friday, July 23rd. Using aerial maps and location photos, we can explore some of Stephanie's last known movements. Let's start with her home. Stephanie lived here at 304 8th Street, apartment 1. It's the ground floor unit on the left. She lived alone here, with her Siberian husky, Keto, whom I'd later learn she used to fearlessly walk along the 8th Street fields early in the morning and late at night. I know this might be difficult to read without the street names and landmarks, but we're going to take a virtual drive through Laurel, starting from Stephanie's apartment. Number 1 shows the corner of 8th and Montgomery Streets. According to police reports, Stephanie was seen multiple times on Thursday, July 22nd, the first being at the hospital that afternoon when she picked up her paycheck. There's no way of knowing exactly what route she took, but this shows the proximity of her apartment on 8th Street to the hospital, taking 198 West to Van Dusen Road. She was scheduled to work later that Thursday night, which was to be her final shift before moving to Texas on Monday, July 26th, the day her car would be discovered instead. The hospital staff had thrown a going-away party for Stephanie on Wednesday, the night before, and she was supposed to meet her cousin Christy in Harrisburg, Pennsylvania on Friday. They were planning a long weekend in Ocean City before Stephanie's big move that coming Monday. Whether she went there directly from the hospital or not, another co-worker reported seeing Stephanie later that afternoon at a bank in the town center shopping center at Conti Road and Route 197. This could have been the Citizens Bank of Maryland on the corner near the Conti Road exit, or John Hanson Savings and Loan, both of which were in the shopping center at the time. The last reported sighting of Stephanie was shortly after 9 p.m. that night, as she was seen by a neighbor leaving her apartment. It's still unclear where she was going. She wasn't scheduled to report to work until 11:30 p.m. One of her former co-workers recently commented on my blog and revealed that Stephanie had been on the hospital's softball team, which often convened for drinks at Max Place Plus One after their games. Max Place was a popular tavern at Laurel Shopping Center in the early 1980s that sponsored and hosted numerous local teams. It was her recollection that the team was planning to meet that night at Max Place for a final dinner with Stephanie. It's a compelling thought given the location of Max Place, tucked in the corner of the shopping center next to Giant, beside what was at that time a dimly lit alleyway that exited to 4th Street, and literally a stone's throw away from the Middletown high-rise where Stephanie's car was found. Could this be the scene of the crime, or at least one of them? The only thing that seems to be clear is that whatever happened to Stephanie occurred that Thursday night, after leaving her apartment at 9 o'clock and before she was due to report for her final hospital shift at 11:30. After 6 long weeks of speculation and angst, the worst fears of Stephanie Watson's relatives, friends, and all of Laurel were confirmed. On Friday, September 3rd, police discovered, quote, partial skeletal remains in the wooded area at the dead end of Larchdale Road. Initial reports stated only that it was a citizen who made the grisly discovery, and on Tuesday, September 7th, the Maryland Medical Examiner's Office confirmed that the remains were indeed those of Stephanie Watson. Positive identification was made with dental records, according to then Laurel Police Lieutenant Archie Cook, who had headed the investigation to that point. He tactfully declined to elaborate on the physical condition of the remains, only to say that various television reports, likely about the partial skeletal remains being only the head, were unconfirmed. The discovery on Larchdale Road marked a transitional phase for the investigation, as Prince George's County Police essentially took over the case. The crime scene was determined to be in an area of Laurel under county police jurisdiction. Sergeant Sherman Baxa of the Prince George's County Homicide Unit credited Laurel Police for, quote, collecting a tremendous amount of data and for cooperating with the PG County detectives as they assumed the reins of the investigation. Sergeant Baxa later released some compelling information about the citizen who'd found the partial remains. He not only discovered them, he'd witnessed a man actually throwing them into the woods. Baxa stated that the wooded area at the end of Larchdale Road had been used as a dumping ground for debris for some time, but the witness who found the remains had, quote, observed an individual throwing something into the woods. He said that the witness became curious, later walked over to the wooded area, and subsequently made the startling discovery. The witness was never publicly identified for obvious safety and privacy concerns, nor was it made clear how he happened to be there to make the discovery. And while he couldn't positively identify the individual he'd seen dumping debris in the wooded area, he provided police with additional critical information. He'd seen the car the suspect emerged from, and he'd seen a second man inside. The car was reported to be a green 1975-78 Ford LTD with a green vinyl roof. A composite sketch was made and published in both the Laurel Leader and Washington Post, citing a white male in his 40s, 6 feet tall and weighing between 200 and 210 pounds. No one fitting the description was ever found. Neither was the car. Despite substantial rewards offered by both Stephanie's parents and Prince George's County crime solvers, none of the countless phone calls made from tipsters produced a viable lead, and the case went cold for the next 30 years. Let's fast forward to 2012. In the midst of curating Lost Laurel, I realized that the 30th anniversary of Stephanie's death was approaching. I wanted to not only mark the occasion, but somehow generate interest and possibly even rejuvenate the investigation into her murder. I started by first trying to find any information online that I could about Stephanie or the case. Only one hit turned up. A footnote buried deep within an online amateur memorial page for Maryland homicide victims. And despite best intentions, it had both misspelled her name and stated the facts incorrectly. Sadly, that's all that seemed to be left of Stephanie Watson. Going through back-issue newspapers online, I was only able to find brief articles in the Washington Post and Baltimore Sun's archives, but a treasure trove came via the Laurel Leader on microfilm. There, on the analog monochrome screen at the old Laurel Library, was the full weekly saga from July to September 1982. All of these newspapers are now digitized at the Laurel Museum, by the way. Much better than microfilm. I was about to discover the Stephanie Watson case all over again, reading the details as they emerged that harrowing summer 30 years ago. I started doing some amateur sleuthing myself and went back to the place where I'd first heard the news back in 1982. I'm still in contact with a lot of old friends from Stewart Manor Apartments. In fact, we have a sort of Stewart Manor alumni group on Facebook, and we have reunions there every summer. I doubt many other apartment complexes can say they have former tenants who fly in from as far away as Los Angeles every year to reminisce with other former tenants, but that's just how it was growing up there for us. Anyway, I started asking my friends, including the older ones, what they remembered about the Stephanie Watson murder. Mark Nelson, one of the big kids who lived upstairs in my building at 100 Bryan Court, and who owned the sweet red Mustang at the time, said something that struck me as compelling, if not unlikely. I'd heard somebody say that the guy who killed Stephanie Watson was the same guy who killed Adam Walsh. The notion that the same man who'd murdered little Adam Walsh the previous year, all the way down in Hollywood, Florida, sounded like a long shot at best, until I started looking more closely at just who that man actually was. And when comparing these new bits of information to those old Laurel Leader articles, I actually got chills. On July 27, 1981, almost exactly 1 year before Stephanie Watson's murder, 6-year-old Adam Walsh was with his mother at the Sears store in their local Hollywood, Florida mall. Like any young boy in 1981, Adam was fascinated by an Atari video game display being played by a small group of older kids. Reve Walsh innocently left her son to briefly watch the gamers play while she inquired about a lamp just a few aisles away. In the 7 minutes she was gone, a Sears security guard responded to bickering amongst the kids by making them all exit the store, including little Adam, who instinctively followed the guard's orders and the other children and exited the nearest door. In that precise moment, Otis Toole was in the parking lot just looking for someone like Adam. and unfortunately, he found him. Adam was allegedly lured into the stranger's borrowed Cadillac with promises of toys and candy. Tool, a deviant drifter already convicted of a slew of bizarre and brutal crimes, confessed to abducting the boy with the intent of simply, quote, keeping him as his own. But when Adam began to cry in panic while driving north along Interstate 95, Tool punched the boy into unconsciousness. Changing plans, he drove the car onto a deserted service road, where he claimed to have strangled Adam to death before decapitating him with a machete he kept under the front seat. On August 10, 1981, a pair of fishermen discovered Adam's head in a Vero Beach, Florida canal. The rest of his remains have never been recovered, leading credence to Tool's claim that he incinerated the boy's body in an old refrigerator. Despite Tool's initial confession as early as 1983, Hollywood police bungled the investigation, inexplicably losing Tool's impounded car and the machete. It wasn't until nearly 25 years later, after an independent investigation by Detective Sergeant Joe Matthews at the behest of John and Reveille Walsh, that police finally officially closed the case, naming Honest Tool as the murderer. While researching evidence files, Matthews had discovered rolls of film, photos taken by crime scene investigators and evidence technicians that had never even been developed. These photos, when processed, turned out to include chilling, detailed images of the missing Cadillac. One set of photos was particularly damning, as it documented a large presence of blood on the floorboard of the driver's seat and the carpet behind it, where Tool admitted to have callously tossed Adam's head before discarding it in the canal. An excerpt from Matthew's book reads, "Traced in the blue glow of luminol was the outline of a familiar young boy's face, a negative pressed into floorboard carpeting, eye sockets blackened black cavities, mouth twisted in an oval of pain." After an exhaustive review of the new evidence in 2008, Hollywood police posthumously charged Otis Tool, who died in prison in 1996, with the crime, and apologized to the Walsh family for the long, painful journey they had endured to that point. But there's much more to the Otis Tool story than just the murder of Adam Walsh, especially when it comes to his relationship with the even more notorious serial killer, Henry Lee Lucas. Henry Lee Lucas first met Otis Tool in line at a soup kitchen in Jacksonville, Florida in 1976. But before joining up with his frequent traveling partner, lover, and confidant, Lucas, a diagnosed psychopath, had already killed before. His first murder in 1960 was that of his own mother. Beginning in 1978, Lucas and Tool embarked on a series of cross-country murder sprees. Lucas would later claim that during this period he had killed hundreds of people, with Tool assisting him in, quote, 108 murders by his estimation. Lucas stated that his preferred victims were young white females. Tool preferred men. Their methods of murder included everything from stabbing, shooting, strangulation, and beating to mutilations, with Lucas having been known to decapitate victims and carry body parts with him across state lines on different occasions. When traveling together, Lucas and Tool were virtually untraceable, making erratic treks from coast to coast. Lucas, on record, later confirmed to Texas prosecutors that in September 1982 alone, the pair had been through Missouri, Indiana, Illinois, Oklahoma, and Maryland. Criminal profilers in various states found themselves stumped at the lack of motive and pattern in some particularly brutal crimes, as was certainly the case with the Stefanie Watson murder. Serial killers, it was commonly believed, usually work alone. The utter randomness of these crimes was virtually unprecedented, especially when they occurred in small communities. The two would occasionally separate, committing crimes on their own before reuniting. It was during one such separation that Otis Tool murdered Adam Walsh. Lucas was arrested in Texas in June of 1983, and almost immediately began confessing to scores of other murders, including many that he couldn't have possibly committed. Enjoying the extra attention warranted someone who boasts of having killed hundreds, even thousands, of people, Lucas seemingly began copping to any and all unsolved cases presented to him. He would then recant confessions just as frequently, further baffling prosecutors. In November 1983, the Lucas Task Force was created for the purpose of coordinating with police agencies across the country. So vast and wide were Henry's claims that Texas authorities gave out-of-state cold case detectives the opportunity to interview Lucas for their own cases. One of those agencies, I learned, was Prince George's County Homicide. The Lucas Task Force was well underway in 1984, when it began to receive criticism for becoming, quote, a veritable clearinghouse of unsolved murder. In fact, police officially cleared 213 previously unsolved murders via Lucas's confessions. It was at this time that Vic Fiesel, an ambitious young district attorney in Waco, Texas, launched a large-scale investigation into the veracity of Lucas's confessions. The result was the Lucas Report, an extensive timeline documenting the confirmed travel movements of Henry Lee Lucas and Otis Toole that conclusively disproved many of Lucas's confessions. In a typical instance, the report showed Lucas cashing checks in Florida, while at the same time confessing to a murder in Texas. But in reviewing these documents online, it was Fiesel's timeline that caught my attention, and actually convinced me that Lucas and Toole might very well have been responsible for one of the few murders they didn't confess to, the Stefanie Watson murder. Fiesel's timeline showed no record of Lucas's whereabouts during July 1982, the time when Stefanie was killed. It did, however, document several of Lucas's travels throughout Maryland. The report included grim information about Lucas's methods, which clearly matched the Stefanie Watson murder profile. But what struck me most was an innocuous line item about a vehicle purchase in January 1982. According to multiple entries in Vic Fiesel's notes, Lucas purchased a 1973 Ford LTD on January 9, 1982. It stated that the car was brown, but that did little to diminish the adrenaline rush that I suddenly felt at that moment. What are the odds, I thought. What are the odds that someone witnessed two men in a 1970s model Ford LTD tossing a partial skull into the woods at the dead end of Larchdale Road, two documented serial killers, erratic drifters, both of whom had connections to Prince George's County, the opportunity, the means, and certainly the will to commit this type of crime. They'd been free at the time of Stefanie's disappearance, confirmed having traveled through Maryland in the summer of 1982, and were driving a 1973 Ford LTD at the time. What are the odds that it wasn't Henry Lee Lucas and Otis Toole who killed Stefanie Watson? Could it really have just been some amazing coincidence, and that two other guys, one of whom eerily fit the description of Otis Toole based on that composite sketch, just happened to be driving an equally similar Ford LTD and tossed a severed head out into a wooded area? Could there really have been anyone else even capable of such a horrific crime, not to mention the numerous coincidences? I started to feel like I'd dropped into an episode of The First 48 or America's Most Wanted or something. Here I was, piecing together a far-fetched cold case theory that suddenly seemed extremely plausible, to me at least. Next, I put a call into the Laurel Police Department, hoping to get any information I could about the case, and to talk about what I'd found and was planning to write about. I found myself on the phone talking to none other than Chief of Police Rich McLaughlin. It was at this point I got a little nervous and made sure to let him know I was only 9 years old at the time of this murder, so he wouldn't start thinking I was the killer checking up on things 30 years later. He remembered that summer of 1982, even though it was years before his time on the force. He explained that, predictably, all of the investigators from that time had since retired, and that PG County had almost immediately taken over the investigation once the remains were found due to jurisdiction. But he encouraged me to call PG County Homicide and ask for the cold case unit. He gave me the number and even told me what to say when I called so I wouldn't be even more nervous. Over the next week, I spoke to Sergeant Rick Fulginetti and Detective David Morissette, both of Prince George's County Homicide. Sergeant Fulginetti confirmed that the case was indeed still open and active, and when Detective Morissette began explaining just a few of the general points that their cold case unit had been investigating, I immediately realized that I hadn't uncovered anything that Prince George's County detectives didn't already know. Go figure. In fact, the very first name Detective Morissette mentioned was Henry Lee Lucas. He confirmed that in 1984, Prince George's County had indeed sent a team of investigators to Texas to participate in the Lucas Task Force questioning. While their suspicions had always lied with Lucas, they simply weren't able to conclusively connect him to the crime. And apparently, their visit occurred during a rare moment when Lucas wasn't in a confessing mood. Wanting to make sure I wouldn't only be spreading more rumors and misinformation about this tragedy, I essentially sought an off-the-record endorsement for the conclusion that I'd surprisingly come to on my own. Detective Morissette simply encouraged me to write the piece exactly as I'd planned, adding that it could even jog some long-suppressed memories or prompt someone to finally come forward with details that they just weren't ready to share over the past three decades. So on August 7th, 2012, having no idea how it would be received by the nostalgic Lost Laurel public, I posted the article, to my knowledge, the first lengthy piece written about Stefanie Watson in this case in three decades. Within days, it generated more comments than any of my other blog posts, and the link to the article on Facebook was even more active. I heard from so many different people who shared equally vivid memories of this crime. I heard from a few people who had theories of their own. I heard from a few of Stefanie's former co-workers at the hospital. I heard from one of her neighbors. And most surprising of all, I even heard from Stefanie's family. I had actually considered trying to contact Stephanie's family before I even started writing, but the fear of opening old wounds for them was great, and being neither a professional journalist or investigator, I just didn't feel comfortable doing that. Talking to Chief McLaughlin and Sergeant Fulginitti reassured me that what I was writing wouldn't impede the investigation, nor should it upset Stephanie's family should they happen to come across it, which was my concern. And amazingly, that October, I received an email from Stephanie's cousin, Leanne Cashman. She explained that her older sister, Christy, had been Stephanie's best friend. In fact, Chris was the one who reported her missing that Friday in 1982 when Stephanie didn't show up. Leanne shared some wonderful memories of their cousin and thanked me for the time I put into writing about her. If the story had ended right there, I would have been happy that I'd done a small good deed in just bringing Stephanie's memory back to the public's consciousness. But it didn't end there. The blog posting continued to generate comments over the next several months, and Leanne and I kept in touch into 2013. Then, on Friday, June 21st, I got an email from her that I never could have expected. She was letting me know that there had been an arrest in Stephanie's murder, and that the DNA actually matched an inmate named John Walsh. "I'm not kidding," she added. My first thought was, John Walsh? This guy? It turned out to be this guy, John Ernest Walsh, a 70-year-old inmate who's been incarcerated on an unrelated charge since 1989. Walsh, we learned, had been arrested in 1969, when he was only 24 years old, for the kidnapping, rape, and attempted murder of a woman in Prince George's County whose throat and wrists he cut before literally leaving her for dead in the woods. Against all odds, she survived, and Walsh was sentenced to 72 years in prison. But unfortunately for society, this was just the beginning of his story. Walsh was considered a psychiatric patient and was handpicked by the notorious Patuxent Institution in Jessup, quote, for rehabilitation. After serving only 8 years, he was deemed rehabilitated, at least enough to be allowed out on work release. That was in 1978. 2 years later, in 1980, he was paroled outright. You heard that correctly. This man kidnapped, raped, and cut a woman's throat, and then ended up only really serving 8 years of a 72-year sentence. And so it came to be that on July 22, 1982, John Ernest Walsh, the rehabilitated kidnapper, rapist, murderer, fatefully crossed paths with Stephanie Watson. Having had his parole revoked in 1989 for failing a drug test, Walsh has spent the last 26 years at Eastern Correctional Institution, where he's inmate number 113067. Preserved DNA from the back of the driver's seat of Stephanie's blood-soaked 1981 Chevette unequivocally matched that of Walsh. Stephanie, it's clear, put up an incredible fight in that small car, as a significant amount of that blood evidently belonged to Walsh, whose face still bears distinct scars. I learned all this in dramatic fashion on Sunday, June 23rd, when I got a call from Sergeant Fulginitti, confirming the stunning news I'd first heard from Leanne. "I've spoken to Stephanie's family and I wanted to call you next," he said, and in what was a tremendous honor, he told me that the Lost Laurel article had indeed helped breathe new life into the cold case. He held a press conference on Tuesday, June 25th, and for the first time since this unspeakable crime occurred back in the summer of 1982, there was no shortage of news coverage. The Laurel Leader, rightfully, was one of the first to break the story. Watching the press conference, I realized something. The photo of Stephanie was the first color photo of her I can remember ever seeing. It was taken from her driver's license and had been in the police file. Seeing her in full color, it was almost as if she'd re-emerged from this 30-year nightmare, having been hidden in some murky black-and-white mystery for an entire generation. I knew I'd have to write a follow-up to the blog post, sharing the stunning news of the arrest, but I had the idea that this should really be more about Stephanie herself, not the man who killed her. I talked to Leanne about possibly using some family photos and learning more about who Stephanie actually was, the music she liked, the TV shows she watched, things that would finally humanize her for this community that had only known her from the missing persons flyer. Leanne put me in touch with her older sister, Christy Torres, who'd been Stephanie's best friend. The first time I talked to Chris on the phone, we ended up talking about Stephanie for almost 2 hours, and I came away feeling like I genuinely knew them both. When I told her how the color photo of Stephanie was such a breath of fresh air, she laughed and said, "That's actually not even a very good photo of her. There are so many better ones, I'll show you." And she did indeed. But before we get to those and find out a little bit about who Stephanie was, there's another amazing story to come out of this, one that's never been told. Among the folks who've contacted me after the break in the case is a junior high social studies teacher from Mesa, Arizona. Todd McEvers has been teaching high school and junior high students about social studies, U.S. history, political science, and business education in Arizona for the past 20 years. He's also a popular basketball and baseball coach. Back in 1982, Todd was a junior at St. Vincent Pilate here in Laurel, and on September 3rd, he was the one person who witnessed John Ernest Walsh drive his Ford LTD to the dead end of Larchdale Road and toss something into the woods. Moments later, Todd McEvers discovered the partial remains of Stefanie Watson. As Todd himself will explain, his family lived in the first house on the other side of the dead end. And in 1982, the dead end was considerably less overgrown, with practically none of the brush and bushes that obstruct the view today. It was here that Todd found himself staring at Stefanie Watson's killer.
Hi Richard, it's Todd McEvers. This is my recollection of the events from October 1982, when I was a senior in high school at St. Vincent Pilate. I was a carpool driver, four other kids. I also at that same time was working at Larchdale Woods apartment complex, which my dad managed. I was just a maintenance groundskeeper, worked full-time during the summer, part-time during school days. It was my job to always pick up the trash and do all the odd jobs that nobody else really wanted to do. I remember during that summer we had been taking out a lot of appliances and putting in new ones. So we had this huge industrial dumpster down by the pool, which was by the dead end of Larchdale Road. And it just so happens on the other side of that dead end was my house where I lived. So that kind of sets the story where it's at. This particular day, and I honestly don't remember what day it was. I want to say Monday or Tuesday, but I honestly don't remember. I was coming home after dropping the kids off, and I was coming down the hill, and I always parked in the street because we only had a one-lane driveway. So as I was coming down, I saw a car coming down the opposite side of the deck, and it was a green Ford LTD, two-tone, and I swear I saw two people in that car. You know, didn't think anything of it because I'm just driving. So I pull into the driveway to back out. And as I do that, I noticed that the car had stopped. This guy, kind of pretty tall, had gotten out of the car. And again, thought nothing of it until I saw a yellow dishwashing glove in his hand, all the way up to his arm. He opened the rear door and reached in with the dishwashing glove, pulled something out, and walked around the back and tossed it into the woods, which were just to the right of the pool. Of course, I didn't want to get out of my car because it just seemed odd. My first thought was, you know, how dare they throw trash on my property? So I was afraid to get out of my car, basically. At this point, I knew something was really off about this. So as the car pulled off and drove away, I went ahead and got out of my car. And my first instinct was, I gotta go check this out. I went ahead and went into the house. My responsibility let the dog out, so I just took it as an opportunity to walk the dog. So I walked across the street, walked towards the pool area, keeping in mind I'm looking for a vehicle in case, you know, he's still watching. I mean, it's only went down there. So I'm taking the dog and we're walking and I'm gonna get a little closer to the woods and I noticed something and I kinda just tapped it over with my foot and realized there were some teeth in quite clearly, I guess, the remains of a partial crushed skull, so I can have to describe it. Well, at that point, I went ahead and just took the dog and I ran back to the house, tossed the dog into the house, locked all the way up to the maintenance shop. And the maintenance supervisor, his name was Greg, and he was kind of like an older brother for me. And could tell by the look on my face that something was wrong. And I told him, I said, I think I found a skull. And they kind of looked at me like, you know, I couldn't possibly. But we all hopped in the truck and drove down. And there was another guy named Chuck. He was also part of the crew. He actually took a stick, picked it up just to get a closer look. And he noticed there were fillings in the tooth. And realized that this was definitely human, not a dog. And he laid it back down. And at that point, we were gonna make a phone call, but sure enough, there was an officer who lived across near the property, coming down the street as he was getting out. He was toward the end of his shift, so he was just kind of wasting time, I guess. We stopped him and rolled his window down and told him what we found. And next thing you know, it started a chain reaction where police all showed up. I ended up having to be interviewed. I met with an artist who would try to draw what I saw. But I got to tell you, at 17, you know, I was kind of overwhelmed. I don't know if scared is the right word, but I never was fully confident with the sketch drawing that they did. Well, nothing ever came of it. Continued to go to school. Went to the prom, cut the prom short because my dad was traveling back and forth. Didn't want to leave mom alone because, you know, just wasn't one of those things you want to risk. Eventually graduated. I think it was around the end of May, 1st of June. And I left town shortly after. At that point, nobody had known anything. I kept it to myself the whole time. I remember getting in touch with someone in Reno where they reached out to me, took us some pictures, didn't see anything, but one always stuck out, but nothing of that came to mind where I continued with, there was nothing happening. And eventually I'm down in Arizona. I get contacted by the police, I don't know what, 3-4 years ago as a result of your blog, reaching out and trying to get them to bring this back to light and make sure Stefanie Watson's murderer is taken care of.
With his dad out of town and working at a new site in Reno, Todd's mother bought a Doberman Pinscher for an added sense of security. Living in such a secluded area, she also requested police assistance, believing it was impossible that the suspect wouldn't immediately know it was Todd who'd been the witness, and he knew where they lived. It was for this reason that Todd's name was never released. The best they could get was a police car parked at the end of the dead end near where the remains were found. Todd eventually graduated in June of 83 and moved to Reno 3 days afterwards. He was contacted in 1987 and asked to come in and look at photos, but nothing came to him as a positive ID, likely because John Ernest Walsh was never on anyone's radar for this crime, until his blood DNA turned up in Stefanie's car 30 years later. You know, I talk about the countless coincidences that just seem to keep coming up in this case. Did you happen to notice anyone else on that page from Todd's 1982 yearbook? Right next to him, in fact, it's Laurel Police Chief Rich McLaughlin. We hear all the time about random, senseless killings, and we search and try to find answers for things that really are just that, random and senseless. It's in our nature to deny things, like the idea that someone as insignificant as a crazy lone gunman can assassinate a president. Surely it's a larger conspiracy or something, right? For 33 years, we've wondered what exactly happened to Stefanie Watson. We may never know the full story, but the picture is finally becoming a bit clearer. The main question, who did it, has been answered, and John Ernest Walsh, the insignificant lone degenerate who randomly crossed her path and took her life, is finally scheduled to go on trial for first-degree murder in March 2016. The unlikely coincidences that permeate this tragic chapter in Laurel's history never cease to amaze me. The sheer randomness of the crime, the timing of Stefanie's last night at work and plans to relocate, the similarities between her murder and that of Adam Walsh, and now the very name of her killer. As they say, you can't make this stuff up. Nonetheless, it happened, and those of us who lived in Laurel during the summer of 1982 have never forgotten, nor will we ever. Laurel just recently celebrated another 4th of July, one that would have been Stefanie's 60th. It's time we remember Stefanie as more than just a victim. She was born Stefanie Sue Wilbert in Harrisburg, Pennsylvania on July 3, 1955. Stefanie's niece, Kate, who had only been 3 months old at the time of her aunt's disappearance, shared these wonderful photos of Stefanie through the years. Here's Stefanie with her older sister, Peg. She graduated from Central Dauphin East High School in Harrisburg, Pennsylvania in 1973. In her junior yearbook, they'd misspelled her name with a PH. Her expression here suggests that she was already getting tired of people misspelling her name, doesn't it? Stefanie would go on to attend Harrisburg Community College. She came to the Washington, D.C. area to attend Columbia Union College, now Washington Adventist University, in Tacoma Park in September 1981, and settled in Laurel after her brief marriage to W. Wayne Watson ended in separation. Stefanie held a number of jobs, working as a clerical typist and in a dentist's office prior to becoming the night admitting clerk in the busy emergency room at Greater Laurel Beltsville Hospital, a job she rightly considered much more than simply filling out insurance forms. Colleagues recalled that she never failed to console families of the sick and injured, bringing them coffee and allowing them a chance to talk about their anxiety and grief. One staff doctor noted the countless cases of, quote, gratuitous and senseless violence that the emergency room saw on any given night shift, and that Stefanie was always, quote, caring and concerned for all the people she met, ingenious and never cynical, even when patients or their families seemed undeserving of her patience and thoughtfulness. The Laurel that Stefanie came to in 1981 was experiencing a renaissance of sorts, with the recent opening of Laurel Center Mall, the newly restored Main Street, and the advent of the annual Main Street Festival. Here, Stefanie found a place to heal the wounds of her broken relationship and begin anew. She lived alone with Keto in the small apartment on 8th Street, a short drive from her job at the hospital. She had a wicked sense of humor, her cousin Chris mused, and she loved the beach. To that point, Deborah Moore, an 18-year-old neighbor who lived in the building beside Stefanie's in 1982, even remembers her sunbathing on the 8th Street field right in front of her apartment. She was fearless, Chris reiterated. She would walk Keto along those fields early in the morning and late at night. Stefanie was only 2 years older than Chris, an obvious factor in their closeness. Her sister, Margaret, known as Peg, while undoubtedly close herself, was 7 years older than Stefanie. But Stefanie and Chris were, by all accounts, inseparable best friends. Speaking to Chris about Stefanie all these years later, the joy in her voice is palpable, as are the memories. "Oh, she was a good time, just a really good time," she said. Chris's little sister, Leanne, commented on this photo in particular. "That's more Stefanie than most other pictures," Leanne said, fondly recalling her, quote, "cool cousin. I look at her face and still see the girl that I thought was so pretty and had great clothes. I would sneak them out of her bag when she spent the night, wear them to school, and have them nicely folded and back in her bag before she and my sister got home from work. They were older than me. Chris is 4 years older and Stefanie was 6 years older. Chris always thought of me as her pesky little sister and would tell me to get lost, and Stefanie would tell her to stop being so mean." Chris also attested to Stefanie's fashion sense and how she was always, quote, super neat and had to make sure everything was cleaned and pressed. I asked about Stefanie's favorite foods, and with a laugh, Chris explained that Stefanie, quote, could eat like a hog and never gain weight. She added that they would often eat frequently and at odd times, undoubtedly due in part to Stefanie's late work schedule at the hospital. Chris thought about restaurants they frequented together in Laurel, and one name instantly came to mind. Tippy's Taco House, she said, knowing that it's still open at 315 Gorman Avenue, albeit under the name Toucan Taco since 1992. The girls would get their Tex-Mex fix, and Chris would even buy more for the trip home to Pennsylvania. We talked about TV shows that Stefanie watched, too. Chris says, "I remember she loved Tom Selleck in Magnum P.I., Happy Days, Laverne and Shirley, One Day at a Time, The Love Boat, Saturday Night Live, when Saturday Night Live was good, of course." Music was a big part of Stefanie's life, and she and Chris often frequented concerts, including several at Meriwether Post Pavilion in nearby Columbia. "We'd go to any concert," she said. "It really didn't matter who was playing, we just loved to go." She cited a number of Stefanie's favorite recording artists, and while the list paints a veritable time capsule of the era, it also attests to her diverse taste in music. "Rod Stewart I expected, Charlie Daniels I did not, but Chris says they both were part of Stefanie's playlist. The Bee Gees, Blondie, Rod Stewart, Charlie Daniels, Marshall Tucker, Christopher Cross, Elton John, David Bowie, Todd Rundgren, and her all-time favorite, Dan Fogelberg, loved him. She was also a huge Steely Dan fan. A few years earlier in Pennsylvania, she'd had another dog named Jackson, because she also loved Jackson Brown. It's easy for us to use terms like playlist today, and forget that this wouldn't have been part of Stefanie's lexicon 30-plus years ago. Chris and I talked about this as well, how there were no cell phones, no internet, none of the modern conveniences that we take for granted today. Consider the things that Stefanie missed out on within just that first year alone. Michael Jackson's Thriller, Return of the Jedi, A Christmas Story, Friday Night Videos, Flashdance, Madonna. Then consider everything she missed over the next 30 years. It's staggering. Stefanie would have just celebrated her 60th birthday on July 3rd, and it's hard to fathom that she's now been gone much longer than she was here. This is especially true for Laurel, where she was really only a resident for a total of 10 months. Even if the unspeakable hadn't occurred, she was literally just days away from relocating to Fort Worth, Texas. I posted this image on the Lost Laurel Facebook page back in July. Laurel's 4th of July celebration in 1982 fell on July 3rd that year, which happened to be Stefanie's 27th and final birthday. She'd go missing less than 3 weeks later. This banner, coincidentally, was directly across from her apartment on 8th Street. I turned 42 this year. That's 15 years older than Stefanie was at the time of her disappearance. It really is amazing how time flies by. And while the rest of us continue to get older and live our lives, Stefanie will always remain that beautiful and kind 27-year-old who loved the beach, her dog, and concerts, and she'll forever be a part of Laurel. I like to think that had she lived, she'd definitely be an active Lost Laurel follower on Facebook, reminiscing over photos and artifacts she'd fondly recall from her time in our hometown. Like anything from Tippy's Tacos. I never would have dreamed, as a little kid 33 years ago, that I'd grow up and contribute a small part to finally catching the man responsible for Stefanie Watson's murder. I've had several people congratulate me for supposedly solving the case, but that's not what happened. All I really did was talk about it, and get other people talking about it again. Yes, I had an interesting theory about what might have happened, but that turned out to be wrong. I'll give you a good analogy. Some friends and I used to play in a weekend warrior football league. There was one particular play where our quarterback threw an interception. It was a freak play. The guy who caught the ball was way out of position, but the ball was tipped and just happened to land right in his hands. Our quarterback blew it off and took a jab at the other team at the same time. He said, "It's okay. He got the interception by playing bad defense." We all laughed, but the bottom line was they ended up with the ball, and that's all that mattered. And that's kind of how I see my part in all this. My article and theory about the Stefanie Watson case was a lot like that guy's bad defense, but it got the ball back, so to speak. And these amazing Prince George's County cold case detectives were able to take it and finally score, and that's what matters. As part of The Rest of the Story, a series based on Ripped from the Headlines, Laurel in the News, the 2015 exhibit at the Laurel Museum, the Laurel Historical Society asked me to give a presentation about the case. It took place on July 9th at the Laurel Police Department's Partnership Activity Center and was essentially the same program you're watching now. But the highlight of that night was finally getting to meet Christy Torres, Stefanie's cousin and best friend, who'd made the drive down from Pennsylvania. When the event was over, she pulled this small wooden box out of her bag and handed it to me. "I want you to have something," she said. "This belonged to Stefanie. It sits on my desk today and will always be one of the most amazing gifts I've ever received." There are still plenty of questions, and hopefully the trial will provide more answers. Stefanie's complete remains have never been recovered. She's yet to receive a proper burial or a permanent resting place. There was a memorial service for her, however, shortly after the identification was made. According to Pastor Arthur Mayer, almost 100 people filled the small Seventh-day Adventist church in Laurel that September afternoon. And there would have been more. Originally scheduled for 7 p.m., Stefanie's family decided at the last moment to change the time to early afternoon so her co-workers from the hospital night shift could attend. For many, including the press, news of the change in time came too late. The hospital also honored Stefanie's memory with a brief but moving service attended by almost 60 members of the medical staff plus friends and family. In a fitting tribute to the young woman who'd comforted so many worried patients there, the family room of the Greater Laurel Beltsville Hospital's emergency room was officially dedicated to Stefanie Watson. The hospital has changed a great deal since Stefanie's time there, though. It's undergone a number of changes and expansions in the years since, including an entirely new emergency room wing. I stopped by earlier this year for the first time since God knows when, and barely recognized it. I had hoped to get a photo of a plaque or something in the waiting room with Stefanie's name on it, something that I could include in this presentation. Unfortunately, but not surprisingly, I didn't have any luck finding that. A kind older lady at the registration desk, who's been there since the late 1980s, remembered hearing about Stefanie Watson, but couldn't recall seeing any plaques in her memory, in either the old or the new wing. That didn't stop her from helping me hunt for it, though. I ended up getting a full-blown tour of the emergency room, which was awesome. One of my fellow Laurel history boys, Pete Lunas, in his inimitable way, made what I thought was a great suggestion when he knew I was having trouble finding that plaque. "Call the hospital's board of directors. Tell them you'll design it," have Dottie's trophies created, and get her name back in there where it belongs. That's what I'd initially planned to do, but I think I've come up with something even better. I'd like to propose that the small road behind the hospital, leading to the emergency room and out to Conti Road, be named Stefanie Watson Way in her honor. As best I can tell, the road is currently unnamed. Ironbridge Lane appears entirely separate to the west, and Banky Drive is separate in front of the hospital as well. And it would be the ultimate permanent tribute, a reminder of her kindness and grace to everyone who passes that way, the same way that she herself drove to work. A dedication ceremony would also be a great opportunity to commend the Laurel Police Department for having the foresight to preserve the evidence that ultimately solved her murder 31 years later. This would also bring closure to Stefanie's family and the community, as the original tribute was made at the beginning of what would become an agonizing 30-year cold case. That case has now been solved, and I can think of no better way than to reinstate the lost tribute to a much-loved hospital employee who brought so much comfort and kindness to emergency room patients and families in her short time there. I think it would also be a tremendously positive story for the hospital itself, which, if you've been following the news, they could use all the good publicity they can get. I spoke to Mayor Moe and Councilmember Fred Smalls, both of whom liked the idea, and Hospital President John Spearman told me there's already strong support for it amongst the Board of Directors, despite their current financial crisis. There's a line from an Elton John song, and we now know is one of Stefanie's favorites, that best sums up my feelings about her, and probably those of everyone else from my generation who grew up in Laurel. And I would have liked to know you, but I was just a kid. Your candle burned out long before the legend ever did. If you enjoyed this program and are looking for more stories that go beyond Lost Laurel, please check out my new project, The Laurel History Boys. I've teamed up with Kevin Leonard, who writes the History Matters column for the Laurel Leader, and Pete Lunas, the preeminent private collector of historical Laurel memorabilia. We started this as a way to pool our resources to find and share Laurel history in a distinctive way. Learn more at laurelhistory.com and follow us on Facebook.